Hey everybody, welcome to Unscripted Access. Nick's out of town and doing a work thing. So I'm Bronson and I'm hosting, and I'm joined by Anthony Ta.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh.
All right. So, Anthony, how you been? How you feeling?
Oh, you know, the usual.
The usual, so just okay, doing all right. I've had a string of I might as well tell the five listeners on this. My cell phone decided to die because it decided to jump out of my hand the other day and fall onto the ground and then flop into some water.
Ooh, man, I didn't know your cell phone had the ability to spring from your hand.
It does. You didn't know that. It's a feature of cell phones. It's
It
weird.
is, yeah, it is the strangest of features. It happened to me once. I was like using it one time, and all of a sudden it decided to enforce greater gravity and fall out of my hand.
I know, just fucking jumped. It was like a cheetah attacking a gazelle.
And you know what? This is a widespread problem here because can you believe the millions upon millions of dollars caught that have been lost because of these things just jumping out of people's hands?
It's Apple needs to really work on this shit.
Like, we need to contact the Onion and get them to write a news story to investigate this.
Anyway. What really happened, but really, that happened, and I looked, and I was like, I called AT&T, and they're like, yeah, even though you've been a customer for 4 years, and you're only, like, not that far away from your upgrade, go, no, you're gonna have to pay full price, or use the next program. And for a while there, I thought my phone was working, because everything managed to come back, for a little bit, but then now just sound cuts in and out, so I'll be listening to a podcast, then silence. I'll be in the middle of a phone call, silence. I'll turn the phone on, no sound, and then suddenly fucking my music starts playing. Yeah, it's pretty I thought it was worse than that at first, but it's still pretty much dead as a dodo. So I had to use the AT&T Next program, which is ironic because when I was hired at AT&T and they told us about that program, I laughed at it and thought it was a dumb idea.
Well, you think about it, there are those people who for some you know those kinds of people who just somehow have a new phone every single year because there's a new iPhone every single year or a new Samsung Galaxy S every single year these days.
Alex, Alex, Alex.
No, it's not just him. Lots of people like freaking upgrade their phones every single year because they announce new phones every year.
Yeah, I
Which
it,
I
you
don't know
know.
how which I don't know how they did it before before this kind of a program existed. I know Verizon, I think Verizon has one also. But I was like, how did you guys pay for your cell phones before these next program stuff? Because they clearly they were doing something to get their new phones every year.
Everyone's probably like, what? Wondering, what'd you upgrade to? A Windows 15, 1520, fucking Samsung? No, I went and got another iPhone. I went from a 4S to a 5S. And on the next program, they do next day shipping, so I got it today. Haven't really had much chance to play with it. I've literally just copied all my crap over to it, and all that I've noticed so far is, wow, the screen is really pretty. That's pretty much the extent of how much I've got to play with it. That and tooling around with the camera, I noticed slow-mo video mode. So now, Anthony, I can capture slow motion videos for you. Because I know Anthony and I do all bunch of live
Slow-mo
action
capture
stuff.
Alex's next backflip.
Dude! Yes!
Yeah, that
Absolutely!
makes sense, doesn't it? Just slow-mo capture his next backflip at Game Expo.
There we go.
Which is certain to happen because the Reno Video Game Symphony has just recently put up a picture on Facebook that says they've reserved. It's happening at the
Yeah,
same place.
and as always, we've been invited back to do a panel.
Yeah, and this time we're
Yay.
gonna make a more entertaining panel, we hope.
Yeah, so
Yeah.
I mean it. So I don't know. I like that it's faster. I like the bigger screen. I like the better screen. I'm not sure if it's worth paying an additional $22 a month for. But I don't know. I guess I'm just gonna have to go out to eat less. That's pretty much it. I don't know. So that happened to me this past couple days. And then, what else? I don't know. That's about it. Just been working a lot. Heads up, everyone. Anthony and I have devised a way to possibly get PS4 footage. And then we've devised.
It's ridiculous, but then again,
We
lots of
found.
things have been ridiculous in
We
our
found.
history of trying to get things recorded.
Well, we found two possible ways. The first way is to pass it through the Xbox One, which I'll be getting out with my tax return whenever they decide to deposit that. And then the other way is through this HDMI splitter. Usually it's used to put one display on multiple TVs. We're doing it because it strips HDCP protection. So
Loopholes.
yay, loopholes. Other than that, not much. I guess we should go into the news, which is Jack Tretton has left Sony.
Wow, he has.
Yeah, Jack Tretton was like, yo, peace. Didn't Nick, I thought Nick and I texted that to everyone.
Yeah. I just said that to try and facilitate conversation. Yeah, I got it through the text.
Okay, I was about to say. I was like, oh, you're surprised at this news. Okay.
Yeah, I was trying to do that to facilitate conversation as if I hadn't heard it so you could explain. Yeah, I don't know much about why he left or where
Well,
he's going next.
I mean, he's been at PlayStation since the beginning, and this is its 20th anniversary in Japan, 19th in America. So, I mean, dude, maybe he's finally gonna retire. I mean, being a CEO at Sony, you probably made a shit ton of money.
Hey, if he's like retiring, he let retired on a pretty darn good note after freaking making Microsoft look bad constantly for that 3 month period.
Yeah, like
I mean, that's a pretty darn awesome highlight for your years, just like making fun of your competitor for screwing up.
I mean, you had probably the most baller E3 presentation of all time, and you then have released what is currently the on pace to be the fastest selling console ever. It's on better pace than the PS2. You launch that in Japan, America, and Europe. I think that's a pretty good note to retire on.
Yeah, it's a very good note to retire on. For one thing, he doesn't have to deal with any potential future collapse of sales if there is one.
Yep.
You know, I mean, my collapse of sales as if, like, say, everyone suddenly got really tired of the stagnant nature of lack of innovation and stuff.
Oh, I feel that is
Which I
so.
don't think is going to happen. I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen in the near future. But in the
Also, I.
event.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry. Well, we can
Yeah,
end this.
but in the event that it does, yeah.
Also, I think there is still a lot of innovation going on and lots of games types
Yeah,
that.
but you always say, oh, indie games are the one driving the innovation. Yeah, but indie games aren't making enough money to make an impact on the industry currently, as far as I can tell.
Well, yeah, but there is still
Like,
innovation
you
in the
look at gaming
mainstream.
revenue, how much does indie games consist of gaming revenue? And then you also look at how much press indie games get that are not Minecraft.
Well, you know what? A very niche game just came out this week that is getting a lot of press. In fact, it's actually getting more press than Titanfall, which kind of surprised me.
Really?
And that is Dark Souls 2.
That's not indie.
It's not indie, but it's very
But
niche.
it's very niche, yes. It's very niche and it's like a medium-sized kind of game, sort of like in the middle between the biggest of the big budgets and then the little budgets
Yeah.
that indies have. Like, it's somewhere in the middle. Yeah, Dark Souls 2 gets a lot of press mainly because it gets a lot of respect from the game
It's a
industry.
you know I'm a big Giant Bomb fan. I listen to their stuff, and like two of their editors have gotten like obsessed with that franchise and got really into it. And they're describing it in its finer points to me, and I'm just kind of like, I want to go down that. There are so many games where I want to go down that rabbit hole, like Dota 2, Dark Souls, Demon Souls, But I just don't want to fucking commit the time to sit down and like learn it. Like I don't want to pound my face against the wall. And part of that is just due to time. Like Kyle Bossman said, like no, you'll make time, which is true. Which I will do for other games, but like part of
Too
it
much
is a
work.
time. Yeah, like it's too much work. As much as I like, and fuck all, man. Like if I was only working one job and PGA wasn't a thing, like you bet your ass I would be in Dark Souls. But that's and I know that because I remember the type of games I played before I had a job and before I was before I'd say before age 16, maybe 17. And long games were king. Like you and I both had to do, you had to do the good grain thing, so did I. I also had to do the allowance thing, and I did the where it's like, okay, if you do all your chores, you get allowance. If not, you
Yeah.
get nothing.
Actually, yeah,
And
to be brutally honest though, when you're younger and games are very expensive, which in our day was $60 is more expensive than the $60 today. We don't get games very often because our parents would say how expensive they were, or we had to pay for it ourselves. So that's why I today still highly care about gaming value. And back then, that's why Oblivion to me was freaking amazing, because it's like that was my only game on the Xbox 360 for like 4 months.
well, so
And
a game like Demon Souls or Dark Souls, like especially Dark Souls. If Dark Souls came out in like 2002, it probably would have been my favorite game. Because like I was one of those people, like I beat Ninja Gaiden on the hardest difficulty. I beat Ghosts and Goblins. Like I liked really hard games, and I wanted games to either be really long or really difficult or have some level of replay value. And I think that's how all kids are because, unless you're one of those lucky kids who was a little bit spoiled, got games a lot.
yeah, for me, I actually prefer games like, well, kind of like Oblivion, actually. It's like not hard, but it's like you can adjust the difficulty, but just like has so much to do that you can't run out of things to do. Which MMOs would have been perfect for me at the time, but I wasn't into them yet.
Like I liked those. I liked those a lot. I was a big fan of the Final Fan. Like I loved Final Fantasy X, and Final Fantasy VII, because those were. I mean, God knows how long those games were. They were like, what? How long was Final Fantasy? I think, well, I'm trying to remember how long Final Fantasy VII was for me. I want to say it was something like. If I had to take a rough guess, Final Fantasy VII. Probably not that 7, 10 probably cost me took me about 70 to 80 hours, 100%.
No, actually, back in the day, a 40-hour game was actually considered normal length for me, at least.
I'm not gonna
Because
say.
obviously, having played, because any game that has 40-hour game length, to me, that would be okay, because it's like, oh, good, this can last me more than a week. However, though, once you're an adult and you have less time, suddenly a 20-hour game suddenly becomes okay.
Yeah, like.
Because, like, for me, shooters just didn't work out, because let's be honest, when I played Halo 3,
Six-hour campaign, maybe
I
seven.
didn't have Xbox Live Gold, so I didn't play the multiplayer. So I played the single player, and I remember I probably finished that in a weekend, or a weekend and a day or two. And I just thought, eh, and then just handed it back, and I'm just like, why would I want to pay $60 for that ever?
So that's actually one thing I will say is when I was younger, like online gaming was kind of a godsend. Like when I got on my first gaming rig and found out about Unreal Tournament, it's just like, wait, I can play with other people in a competitive setting as much as I want for free. And I just keep playing. And like it blew my mind. That's why Halo 2, because that's why Halo 2 is one of those games where I told you I killed 25,000 people total. So Or
Wow.
no, I, you know, I play, what was it? What was that figure I gave Nick? I think I played something like, what, 7,000 matches or something? I don't know, it was some ridiculous stat. But no, like I definitely get the value proposition, and I understand, like, you know, you get it. Like, let's say you buy Metal Gear Ground Zero, like you and I buy Metal Gear Ground Zero, and it, let's say it's an amazing experience, but it's 6 hours long. We're not gonna be too mad because it was $30, and it was a great game, and we'll probably score it as an eight and say, well, that was a little short, but at the end of the day, I'm just gonna go work and earn some more money, and maybe I can get some trade and credit at GameStop. But like a 10-year-old, 15-year-old, basically until you can work, is gonna be super pissed. He's gonna be so mad. Like he's gonna be super pissed. And you know, like, and that's his right, because God knows when I was that age, like super short games bummed me out.
Yeah, super short games also I consider really bad value. To this day, still sort of do. Sort of. But super short games is just kind of like, yeah, that to me doesn't represent good value. Now, there's a lot of things that could judge good value. Like, for example, The Last of Us isn't particularly 40 hours long, depending on how you do
It's
things.
12. It's
It's
gonna be
only
12.
12 hours long, but I would still pay $60 for it because, yeah, it may not have game length, but at least it has the quality, the detail, the story, the looks, the sound.
Well,
Like, yeah.
I mean, like I can think of games that are fucking barely 6 hours long that, because of certain factors, I was like, yeah, I'll pay full price for
Journey's
that.
probably a good one. I would happily pay full price for Journey.
Yeah, Journey was $15, and
Yeah,
it
and it's
was
only
2 hours long.
and we literally played it in 1 hour 30 minutes.
Yeah, and your
On
first
six
time.
on yeah on 60-minute access, and you know
And.
what? I would happily pay $15 for that 1.5 hour adventure.
Yeah, like Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze, I got to the second to last world before I had to return it so we could do 6 minutes of Dark Souls. But getting there took me about 6 hours, so that game probably took 8.5 hours to beat. But first off, as a kid, I would go back and do the secret stuff, which I won't do now as an adult, so that game's probably actually more like 15 to 20 hours. But even then, 8 hours for Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze, that game is awesome. That is a great Wii U game. That is a wonderful game. It looks great. And Anthony, I'm not sure if it's going to be a like game of the year runner because this is going to be a big year, but I do think that it's going to be one of the best soundtracks of the year.
Ooh, I should probably start listening to it then.
Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze, or Returns Tropical Freeze, is a fucking amazing game. It's a lot of fun, and especially if you grew up in like the old school era of platformers, like I did, and Anthony did, you'll probably love it.
Old
It's
school being the late 90s? It's no
mid
longer
to
the early 90s?
mid to late
What madness is this?
mid to late 90s.
Yeah, because it
Yeah.
used to be, I always think it's like, oh, old school. I always thought that was the early 90s or earlier, but now that has become the late 90s.
Yep, man, it's gonna be really weird when
Because
it's early.
freaking 20 years ago was 1994.
And how weird is it gonna be when we get to the point where the early 2000s are old school?
Dear goodness, we're gonna like continue to worship our GameCubes.
Yeah, like that's, like we're gonna bring up GameCube. It's
We're
gonna
gonna
be
bring up
like.
GameCubes, we're gonna worship the GameCube and Sega, and just look down upon those people who care too much about the PlayStation.
Back to the Jack Tretton thing, because we got wildly off topic, as we always
Yeah.
do, but I want to bring it back home. I don't know, this could be bad for Sony. Jack Tretton made a lot of really good decisions, and he's a good businessman, and I will say this about Jack Tretton. In every interview I've seen with him, and every time that he's been out in the public, and every time he's been on camera, he actually seems like he gives a shit about the consumer. Like, he actually seems to give a
So
fuck.
he is a better executive for looking like he actually cares.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, that's all these fuckers. It's a contest of which one of these guys. Like, at those E3 press conferences, none of them are relatable to you. It's just who can look the most. And Jack Tretton is the master of that. Like, he actually seems like he gives a shit. Don Matrick, I just wanted to punch in the face.
Well, you don't have to worry about Don Matrick driving Microsoft into the ground anymore.
Oh, they got a new guy to do that.
Yeah, but even the new guy's failing at that, which is a good thing. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Because the moment Don Matrick left was when everything suddenly started getting better, for strangely enough.
Yeah,
But yeah, I
so
don't really know much about Jack Tran, to be honest. I don't pay much attention to Sony in general, but I
I
just
thought it
remember
was.
him. I just remember him as the guy who thinks maybe too much. It's like, I would like to thank our consumers, our providers, the man, the janitor that cleans the PlayStation shelves, the guy who stocked our game on the shelf. We'd like to thank this guy, our indie developers, the man who somehow cleaned their offices. I'd like to thank this guy. This, like, I remember the one year I think I felt that he thanked way too many people forever. Yeah. But aside from that, though, yeah, he seemed maybe a little dry,
I don't know.
but not just, but at least he wasn't, as far as I could tell, at least I wasn't disliking him.
I don't know. I'll say one thing. The guy had some personality because I remember during that Game Trailers interview last year, he at the end of the interview, when he realizes that they totally rocked E3, he drops the microphone. And I'm just like, okay. So all of Sony last E3 was just cocky and fucking owned that shit. It was hilarious.
Yeah,
I mean,
and it was also pretty cool because you think about it, before E3 started, we weren't feeling good about the Xbox One or the PS4.
no.
Because I remember it too, because like the Xbox One had just been announced and is basically the least likable console we've ever seen in recent memory. And the PS4 had too many question marks to the point where we're like, you know what? We're gonna go Wii U only this time around. Yeah.
And man, did that look stupid in hindsight.
Yeah, but at the time we didn't know anything.
And even then I
Like
thought
we
like,
weren't really sure if Sony would like we weren't sure if Sony was gonna come out looking awesome or mediocre. We just well, we only knew that they wouldn't look as bad as Microsoft.
I mean, I was like, I heard bad things coming from all camps, so I was like, all right, well, now's the time. Better start getting
Yeah, like
paced
maybe
together.
what we were concerned about was that the PS3 was, sorry, not PS3, PS4 was going to be like a gigantic media box.
Well,
And
yeah,
the Wii U seems like the last fortress of gaming enthusiasts.
I mean, I thought I was gonna be building a gaming PC, like building one, because I thought I was gonna be like, oh man, looks like PC's gonna be my primary platform now. Let's see, all right, let's see, a 670 will cost me this much. Da-da-da. Like I was ready, and then at first, as Sony showed off the PS3 stuff, I was like, okay, good to know they're supporting their old platform. I'm glad about that.
It's
And then
like,
they
good, our
show.
PS3s can help put off the impending doom of consoles.
And then okay, a little bit of Vita stuff, that's nice, whatever. And then they start showing media stuff, and I'm or no, they show a little bit of PS4 stuff that looks really promising. I'm like, oh okay, that was really cool. All that indie stuff, that's really neat. Then they show the media stuff, and I'm like, nobody cares, nobody cares, nobody cares. Please stop, please stop, please stop. And then they just fucking go nuts. They're like Kingdom Hearts, Final Fantasy, Mad Max, Infamous,
Seven indie games in 5 minutes.
seven indie games in 5 minutes.
Something like that.
And then they're like, it plays used games. It never needs to hook to the internet. And to finish this all fucking off, it's $399. Santa's giving blowjobs in the parking lot. Like fucking Jesus. Oh man.
And you know
So
what? What they were stating was just common sense. Like, you'd think, like, Jim Sterling pretty much said it. It was like, we were applauding because they were being the least dumb, but because the alternative looked so bad, we had to applaud for the fact that we can still continue to have a normal gaming system. Because the alternative was that bad. It's like,
And it.
man, the original concept of the Xbox One as we knew it was just terrible.
I mean.
That was like That was like, this is the end of console gaming as we know it, if this somehow gets popular.
And to, you know, to be, and Sony then and still, not as much as Nintendo, but still, their mantra seems to be, we're putting the games and the gamers first.
This is the PlayStation.
Yeah, and
yeah, I mean, to be honest, if you're called the PlayStation, I do believe you actually have to focus on that.
Yeah, I mean, they courted indies, they got the indie vote, they got a lot, they got their first party exclusives. They have the better version of all the multi-plats right now, and as of right now, PSN Plus is not only cheaper than Xbox Live, but it's better than Xbox Live. You know, like they somehow pulled off the comeback. They did it. They somehow did it.
What, you mean they were in the hole at some point? For there to be a comeback, you kind of need to be in a hole, and they weren't. I don't think they were actually
they
in
were,
a hole.
Yeah, they were not in a hole. To be fair, the PS3 tied. Like, it tied.
Yeah, that's not what I call being in a hole. Being into, like, if you want to talk comebacks, you talk about the PlayStation 3. Where it went from literally being this bloated, overpriced, possibly overpowered, complicated, complex machine that no one wants to make stuff for because it's too hard, to a system that actually tied its main competitor.
Yeah, and I mean, yeah, you look at how much had to change for that to happen, though.
You had to, like, strip out a lot of things. Flash memory goes out the window, and so does all the PS2 bits. USB ports.
Not only that, but they had to lower, they finally lowered it to $300, and in my opinion, there were two things that really turned the tide. It was a slow, gradual process. Like, Metal Gear started to get some momentum to it's like a football game, almost. You know, Sony started to get a little momentum with Metal Gear and Little Big Planet. And then Killzone comes out, and the multi-plats are starting to get even. In fact, they got the better version of Burnout. Okay, and Resident Evil. Okay, now the real tide turners were the price cut down to $300 with the Slim, and them go say, and then Uncharted 2.
I think the Slim is a very big one. Because you think about it, the original PS3, when they were stripping things out of it, it was still the same big, bulky thing. Granted, it was nuclear bunkered engineered, but it was still this big, bulky thing that probably was... I'm pretty sure they didn't start saving a lot of money until they switched to the Slim.
No, and then they started to market their first-party titles. They said, yo... You want some awesome games? Well, we got awesome games. Check out Little Big Planet. Check out the Uncharted games.
Yo, guys, do you want to see 200 of the most beautiful cars you've ever seen in a racing game? Here you go.
Yeah, Gran Turismo finally came out.
Gran Turismo is still a very big deal considering the 5 was, meh.
Very.
It's very meh when you're not driving.
And then...
But still, though, like, freaking... I bought my PS3 Slim, and to be honest, yeah, it's nuclear bunkered engineered, but you know what? It's still nice.
Yeah, and...
how should I say this? Like, not only did they probably save a lot of money by switching to the Slim, but I recently opened up my PS3 to dust the thing. The inside of the PS3 Slim is really, really nice. Now, the first revisions were... The first, like, actually, I got the, how should I call this? Let's just call it the 2000 series and 2500 series and 3000 series. I got the 2000 series were a little cheap because when I looked at the teardown kit, I noticed that they were using tape to hold down the wireless antennas. I think that, if there's one way to scream cheap, it's using tape. But I got the 2500 series, which is like a very, very minor revision after. Probably the best revision of PS3 because it still keeps its lights, it still keeps all the stuff, and the inside of it's really nice. They put some really good quality bits in there. Like, the plastics are nice. The metal was nice. The EMI shield looks pretty darn good. Now, the Xbox 360. Not so much, but, you know.
Yeah, I don't know. Good for Jack Tretton moving on to retirement or whatever he's going to do next. You know, he did an excellent job with the PlayStation brand. I mean, he launched four consoles, two portables, all of which have been a success in some way. You know, good on him. Hopefully he does well wherever it is he's going. I probably think retirement, because he probably has a ton of money in the bank, and, you know, you work at the same place for 20 years, I imagine that's where you'd retire. So, what was our next piece of news? Do you remember?
No, unless you want to get to really small news.
Might as well talk about these. So, today, March 12th, for about an hour to 2 hour period, the Microsoft Store had a glitch where if you entered the promo code 1, just the number, you get $100 off any item. This includes the Xbox One Titanfall bundle. So a bunch of people got Xbox Ones for $400 with Titanfall.
And they decided to honor all of this?
They haven't said.
Because I highly doubt Microsoft's going to honor. Like, I remember this one time way back last year, Razer had this like 66% off coupon code, and this got leaked out, and everyone started buying their gaming tablet, which you know, it was this gaming tablet that they got like a few 10,000s of petitions to build a Core i7 gaming tablet, which I think was a really dumb idea, but hey, they got the petition, so they did it. And this coupon code leaked out, people used it, and got their tablets for cheap, and Razer decided to honor all of those. Damn. So they basically sold all those systems at a loss.
Yeah, but man, how much good press did they get from that, probably?
Well, think about it, though, if you are... I think Razer is a private company right now, because otherwise their stock would have plunged off the cliff if they said, sure, go ahead. But that probably did not look very good on their financial sheets.
Yeah, probably not.
I mean, at the same time, is it good press? I have no idea. The fact that you decide to honor it kind of concerns me the next time it happens, because now people are going to be like, oh my goodness, these guys honored a leak, which no one ever does. Because let's be honest, when you have a leak, you obviously say that's not supposed to happen, and you just refund people's money, and that's it. But, yeah. Well, I understand that they're working really hard to be the gaming enthusiast company with all of their gaming products and endorsements from professional esports gamers and stuff.
I mean, to be fair, like, they are... Like, I know a lot of tournament players for multiple games, and they are the choice of keyboard and mouse for a lot of people.
They get a lot of endorsements from esports people, like the big esports people, like professional StarCraft players, League of Legends players, you know, stuff like that.
I mean, the only people the only thing of theirs that I don't see endorsed, and I see people endorsing something else, are their headphones. They have great headphones because I've used them. Alex has a pair, but personally, I prefer the Astros. And I've seen, and what I can have seen, a lot of, you know, professional gamers prefer the Astros. But still, when the fact that a lot of professional gamers use their peripherals, you know, like that says a lot.
Yeah, speaking of this, small news, since we're on the topic of Razer, they actually have claimed that they have this new keyboard design, mechanical keyboard design, and I think they patented everything, where they reduce the travel of the key so you get a more instantaneous response. Because if you're an esports gamer, you very, very highly that you get an instant response as quickly as possible from when you push a key. Now, from traditional mechanical keyboard sense. They're pretty much, I think, the same design as what you would find on the cash register keys. So the travel's kind of long. So Razer kind of came out with this new design where the travel isn't as much. So when you push the key, you get that tiny bit faster response, which, again, like in esports, could mean the difference between winning and losing, because you care about every single little thing to the point of obsession, and it boggles my mind how people. Yeah.
It's basically like in the
fighting game scene. That's a good one. Like, you care so much about your latency. You not only count the frames, but you care that you get zero input lag, which is why you don't use a wireless controller, because it takes too long for the signal to get to the system and register. Wires travel faster. So, you know, stuff like that. All for, you know, those few precious milliseconds. But
hey, man,
much like how in racing, how in racing where a win can be decided by a couple inches, in gaming that can be, in esports that can be the same thing. So, you know, every little bit helps, even though it's really expensive.
Well, no, yeah, the same thing is with Halo. Like, I told you when I got, I played a lot of Halo 4 when it came out competitively. Not, like, pro competitively, but I play a lot of ranked games. And the difference for when I'm wearing my Astros is there. Like, I can hear steps behind me. I can hear where shots are coming from. That a good set of headphones is incredibly valuable. You know, so, I mean, and I imagine the same thing with a keyboard and controller. Fight stick, like, I own a fight stick. The level of control, you know, is super, is needed for that type of game. Anyway, so next piece of news we have here is Dark Souls 2 players, granted this game's only been out a day now, everyone, day and a half, have died, and it's already sold roughly over a million copies. I'm reading that wrong. But so far, there have been 4.3 million deaths.
So, Dark Souls 2 is out, and as of today, March 14th, how many deaths happened?
Well, this is as of March 12th, the day we're recording this.
Oh, March 12th, sorry.
It is 4.3 million deaths have happened.
How many days has it been since it came out?
One and a half.
Wow, dear goodness, that's like mass... That's just like mass deaths everywhere. Just like... The only way you could probably outnumber that is if you start nuking cities.
I mean,
in the real world, the only way you can achieve that number currently is to nuke cities, or if some giant earthquake caused New York to fall, New York or most of California to fall in the water. Which actually, that's not possible because I read that you can't have an earthquake that makes California coastline fall into the water. You need like some catastrophic world event to get a number that high in a day and a half.
Yeah, well, Dark Souls 2 did it in a day. I just actually just finished installing it. Funnily enough.
Wow.
That is our 6-minute access game this upcoming week. So after you're listening to this, you should go watch us be a part of the,
at that point, 6.5 million deaths that have occurred.
Well, if they keep on pace for when this comes out, then it'll be something like 12 million. So, that's if they keep on pace, though.
Wow, 12 million deaths. That's like the plague. That's like Black Plague.
No
and
shit.
Being Dark Souls probably isn't surprising.
I don't know, like... Once again, I said that if I had the time, I totally would want to get all over. Like, if I had the time, I would totally just devour those games. But I have a life. sad to say.
I have a life too. However, I still have time to commit to one game. Unfortunately, that game happens to be an MMO, so yeah, sorry.
Yeah, it's like I have a life. It's called World of Warcraft.
It's like, no, I have a life, except my gaming free time can't have room for more than two games, one small normal game and Final Fantasy 14.
Yeah,
Sorry.
mine's the same way. It's like whatever the
If I
game
have
is.
to play Dark Souls, I would have to give up on Final Fantasy, which I'm not doing anytime soon.
Exactly.
MMOs. Friggin', I totally understand the like the addiction part. I mean, it like the game doesn't have enough end game content right now for me to consider playing it for like 8 hours a day, so I'm really wondering what the Burning Crusade days were really like now.
Oh God, you wanna pure evil? That got Quinn to quit running track. So I mean, that should tell you right there.
Yeah, that is like, oof, wow, I'm glad FF14 doesn't do that yet. Yet.
Yeah, so anyway, moving along with our news
Barrage
here.
of small news stories. We don't
Yep.
exactly have any big ones at the time we're doing this.
Yeah, well, it's been a slow news week because games came out this week. It's just that one of them just came in the mail today for me, so I can't talk about it. Another one's Titanfall, which I'm not buying the PC version when I'm gonna get a free copy with my Xbox in a week or two. So
Well,
you
that's gonna
see.
be pretty annoying because I'm not gonna play with. Well, to be honest, I'm not buying the game anyways.
Yeah, you're gonna buy a PS4 for Destiny.
Yeah, like that's what I'm probably saving up my funds for. Just like, don't buy stuff, just game on Final Fantasy 14 for the next 10 months and save money.
And then Destiny
Because
comes
that's how
out.
I could realistically feel okay with, you know, my current funds buying a PS4 is to not buy anything else until then.
Yeah, then, well, then you are gonna have the choice, have to go through the choice. So I've talked to my boss, and I looked at my, and if I keep working the way I'm working right now, I will. The days aren't finalized yet, but I should be able to go to PAX. So, and Anthony, I know you only have two classes next semester, and I know Quinn has leave. Do you know
Well,
what?
if I go to PAX, then the PS4 is not going to happen.
So you have a choice to make.
Yeah.
But
Well, the PS4 and Destiny will always wait for me.
that's true.
I could buy that any day after it comes out.
That's true.
PAX is only once a year. PAX Prime, I
Pack,
mean.
pack, yeah, I was about to say, no, there's PAX Australia and PAX
So, yeah,
East.
if I was willing to pay for like, you know, a $5,000 plane, sorry, a $3,000 plane ticket in addition to really expensive hotels in a very beautiful city, sure.
PAX is thrice a year.
Yeah.
But like I said, but I'd be happy with either because I'd get to hang out with you more, which that's always good. I'll say that I know Aaron said he is waiting until Destiny. He was going to buy it with Infamous, but he changed his mind. So looks like Nick and I are going to be the next Jenners on staff, which means Game of the Year awards are going to be awesome.
Next Jenners, Generation Z now. It's like the way you're
Yeah.
saying it, it's kind of like a family generational BS talk now.
But no, but seriously, if Nick and I are the only ones with a PS4 and an Xbox One, other than the rare multiplayer game you play with me for 60-minute access, imagine how those conversations are going to go for Game of the Year awards.
Yeah, it's just gonna be like, okay, Nick and Bronson, you're gonna decide the fate of half of our awards now.
It's like Nick is like, Titanfall's amazing. Fuck you. It's all about fucking Octodad.
Meanwhile, in the previous gen corner, actually, you know, Aaron's not with us.
Kyrie, you'd be talking to Kyrie.
It's like, hey, Gary, let's just do something on the PS3.
Yeah, well, I might talk with you guys on that because Dark Souls,
I mean, I guess you could consider Wii U next gen. It's just we kind of don't
It's the
really.
most next gen. What are you talking
It's
about?
next. Well, yeah, from a controller standpoint, you could say that. Because let's be honest, the PS4 and Xbox One controllers are just kind of they're just like little tweaks, or just they're just basically the same controllers as before. They just look different or function a little differently.
Yeah, that's so. I mean, Well, only thing I don't like about the Xbox One controller is the bumpers. And I think the PS4 controller is perfect. And the Wii controller is really comfortable, but I constantly forget that they're shoulder buttons.
Yeah, it's not just, but yeah, but the other problem with the Wii U controller, it's like, hey, congratulations, you've got only 4 hours of battery life. Oh, and a bigger battery will cost you $32. And you
Yeah,
can only
fuck
get it
that.
from the Nintendo store. Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm looking at Nick and I's most anticipated games list, and I just want to review this real quick here for everyone. I'll read Nick's first. Halo 5, if that makes it out this year, I'll be shocked. Watch Dogs, The Order, Titanfall, The Division, Metal Gear Ground Zeroes, Infamous, Metal Gear Phantom Pain, Uncharted, if that makes it out this year, good luck. And number one, Destiny. On my end, Octodad, Destiny, Comic Star Heroine, Transistor, World of Warcraft Warlords of Draenor, Metal Gear The Phantom Pain, Persona 4 The Ultimax Ultra Suplex Hold,
Wow.
Kingdom Hearts 3, Infamous Second Son, Bayonetta 2.
Okay.
I see a lot of conflict in the future.
Well, I don't even have to look at those lists to know there's conflict in the future. How do you think the last 2 or 3 years went?
I mean, like, there are some crossover. Destiny is on both lists. Phantom Pain is on both lists.
Yeah, and in the past,
And Infamous.
Last of Us was pretty easy to agree on.
Yeah, Last of Us was just like you, Nick, and I saying fuck yes, and Aaron being like no. And yeah, like Aaron agreed Mario was two, and I thought Mario was two.
You know what? Like, to be honest, though, now that I've played Super Mario 3D World, I would have been okay with Super Mario 3D World being a number one, but at the time, I haven't played it.
Well,
So
you
for me, it
know.
was like Last of Us. It's like, yeah, Last of Us is highly respectable, but Mario 3D World is what puts the smile on my face, and I think I kind of like that a bit more at, when I put the two next to each other.
Donkey Kong
But
puts a
at the
smile on my
time,
face while making me very angry.
I can imagine that look. It's like the person that's trying to force a smile, but at the same time is choking somebody.
Yes, very similar. I don't know. I look at both these lists and I feel as though Nick likes a more cinematic, blockbuster-esque experience.
That seems like him, all right.
I like video games.
What? Those games he wants coming, he likes to come aren't video games?
Well, no, I mean, I like a more traditional video game. And I also like dumb shit. So, I mean, Octodad, that's just silly. Destiny, okay, that's. Cosmic Star Heroine is a 16-bit RPG based around Chrono Trigger and Phantasy Star. Transistor is a indie RPG. World of Warcraft Warlords of Draenor is video game heroine. Phantom Pain, okay, that's cinematic. Persona 4 The Ultimax Suplex Hold is a fighting game. Kingdom Hearts 2 is another kind of cinematic RPG. Infamous is on both. And then Bayonetta 2. Bayonetta 2 is nothing but gameplay and insanity. That's all that it is. It's just nuts. It's just it's absolutely nuts. Bananas. So bananas. So yeah, I don't know. We'll see, obviously, when we get to that list. But Bayonetta 2 is a Wii U game.
Yep.
How great is that news?
It's a Wii U game, and from what you're telling me, it's like Nintendo was the only place it could go. Because no one else will let it go elsewhere. Because they won't give the funds. I don't know.
What I know is what I know is the first game was great and sold okay. not amazing, but not horrible. The first game was great. It's one of my favorite 360 games. And if you haven't played it and you like action adventure games, you should absolutely go play it because it's $8. Anyway, going forward, back to news. Smash Bros. Comes back to the world's biggest fighting game tournament. Evo wasn't showing up on, or Smash Bros. Wasn't showing up at Evo or Major League Gaming events, but a lot of fans protested with the hashtag Free Smash. And Shoryuken is reporting that Nintendo has approved Smash in 2014. It said that it is Smash Bros. Melee. It will be in Evo and MLG events, not the Stone Development sequel that's due later this year. Smash's return to tournament rosters is a big deal. It's noteworthy, especially since after Nintendo's misguided attempts to remove Smash from Evo streams last year. Hopefully, this year's Smash presence will be drama-free, except for the fights, of course. So, yeah, Smash is coming back to the fighting game tournament scene.
Is it like the tournaments like ooh, you can't use items and you can only flat fight on this particular flat stage? It's
Anthony,
those kinds, right?
you already know the answer to that question. Yes.
This is the problem I've always kind of had with Smash Bros. Tournaments. It's just like, there's a reason why I like Smash Brothers. It's because you have stupid things like items, just, it kind of has the Mario Kart effect, just not as bad. And yes, you can have a competitive spirit to it. I certainly had that. But at the same time, it's like, Nintendo never really designed this to be like any kind of Street Fighter. It's just kind of like it was pretty much kind of like a party game that people just happen to play intensely and think they can make a tournament and tier list out of it.
So, I don't know about you, but I went to a Smash tournament in high school, and it was a 2v2 match. And everyone, there were people like us that agree that game is way more entertaining, even a tournament setting with everything turned on. And then there were try-hard fag lords who wanted to turn all that shit off. And we lost in either the second or third round, and that was that. And my opinion is that game is at its. This is Smash Bros. At its best. 5 o'clock or later in the evening, 3 to 8 friends surrounded around Wiis and/or GameCubes, rotating off on controllers, with all items, all characters, all stages, and preferably random character and stage select. That is when that game is at its peak. A lot of people are going to disagree with me, but those people can go jump off a bridge. I'm sorry, that game is like, I play a lot of fighting games. I love fighting games. Anthony knows that last year I bought a $70 fight stick off Craigslist because I couldn't afford a regular one, but I wanted a tournament edition fight stick, and just so be it, someone had the Street Fighter one. So I bought a $70 PS3 fight stick. I love, like I said, one of my most anticipated games of the year is a fighting game. I'm super excited for the new Street Fighter. There's a bunch of reasons I'm excited for. But as a fan of fighting games, Smash Brothers is not one of those. I'm sorry. It's just not.
I mean, the way Nintendo designed it too and talks about it, they're not really talking about it as it's like supposed to be a super hardcore fighting game. Because let's be honest here, you can kind of tell when they're not really balancing things the way a super serious fighting game would. And maybe they'll do that with this next Smash Bros. They'll just patch and say, okay, Pikachu's Thunder won't be ridiculously retarded anymore. We're sorry.
Why would you take out the most fun of that part of that game?
It's not really fun if you are the one who constantly has to deal with it.
Hey, there are plenty of ways to deal with Pikachu
Look,
bullshit.
that's 20, like, that is nearly 20 years of Pikachu's bullshit, okay? Pikachu has ways of knocking people off the stage that don't involve dropping the same attack over and over. Like in Brawl, they made it only like 0.1% better by saying, okay, you use the same attack over and over, it'll slowly get weaker. Yeah, that was very funny. Did do any to do anything.
Smash Bro. So developers of Smash Brothers, I want you to keep Pikachu entirely the same. Don't touch him. Leave Pikachu alone. He hasn't done anything to you. Perfect the way he is.
Well, yeah, of course. Well, yeah, Pikachu has done something. It's called pissing off a lot of people, of like a lot of people. To be honest, though, if you're a competitive Smash Brothers player, you'll pretty much learn how to deal with that stuff very easily. It's called dodging.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I don't get
Like,
why.
actually, because that, like, that's the other thing too. Now, obviously, if you're new to Smash Brothers, or you're not exactly a fight, like, super hardcore fighting game kind of person, like, I don't know, most Smash Brothers players, the Pikachu Thunder is really annoying. It almost always is. It is the perfect noob tool. However, like a lot of noob tools, they can be beaten somehow. Like, I just want to take it out because, let's be honest, I don't play that game as much as I used to, and it's still incredibly annoying, and it just kills the fun.
I use that move all the time, and quite
Yeah,
honestly,
but you're basically killing the fun when you do something like that. I
oh,
personally
you are.
think.
I disagree. I think that game is,
It's
it
fun
is
for
fun.
you, which is why you don't notice everyone else getting tired of it.
But hey, you know what? Stop it then.
It's like someone's constantly poking at your ear constantly, and you can't do anything about it.
Pikachu is a ragdoll in that game, and also Pikachu's other attacks, other than his headbutt, are mad weak.
Well, I wouldn't say they are that weak.
So I mean, it's not like that OP of a move, but whatever. We can have this discussion later.
Yeah. What I can say though is that it is dodgeable. And if you think about it, a person who spams that move is very predictable. And if he's very predictable, you can dodge it. And then I mean, one particular thing I remember back in the day when Smash Bros. Brawl just came out is when I go online, a lot of people like to play as Ike, you know, the man that says, "I fight for my friends." Fucking awful quote.
I just all I remember Mike was Rah! Just screaming.
Yeah, he does a lot of that too, and then he has the terrible victory quote to go on top of that. But I remember a lot of people like to play as Ike because of his big sword. He can KO people with just he can KO people with 80% damage. Like, he knocked people out of the stage pretty easily, and he wasn't exactly the slowest of the slow, so he kind of had enough speed to get it done. And it was really annoying because Ike players would, you know, get easy quote KOs. And everyone played as Ike. The thing I've noticed after some time is that they all do the exact same thing. So if you just time your dodges really well, because they're so predictable, you're pretty much make their day a nightmare, because they can't hit you very easily. So and Ike is slow enough that you can pull these dodges off if you time it right. So that was a pretty cool moment.
Okay, I'm gonna move us on to our next little news story here, or piece of content, and that is that Kotaku did an article, "The Best Video Games to Play with a Friend," and they gave us a small list for different reasons. The first one, Portal 2.
Best cooperative experience I've
Best
ever
oh. It's definitely up
had.
there. I played that game with Mitch Marsala, and man, that game was just it floated in between I love Mitch and this game and having fun in this game, and Mitch has become one of my best friends, to Mitch is a horrible human being who is dumber than a sack of potatoes. And he probably said
Yeah,
this
but it also turns into Mitch is an evil, scheming scumbag that's trying to kill me.
Yes.
I remember those things too when I played cooperatively.
Lara Croft and the Guardian of Light. This one I can't really speak for. Catherine. Yeah, I can see Catherine being a fun game to play with friends. It's a straight up single player. This is what they say: a straight up single player game that works well with a friend or even in a room full of friends. Hand the controller around doing frustrating puzzle sections, but make sure everyone weighs in on the moral choices.
Ooh.
I see how that could be fun. I mean, We essentially do this every week during 60-Minute Access, and I think Catherine could be a great game. Maybe a super mega awesome game. I'm
Ooh,
just
you never know.
saying. Moving forward, Beyond Two Souls. I like one person controlling Iden, another Ellen Page. Ugh, I don't know. Weird. Puppeteer. I get it. I get why you would do it, but even then, no. Mario Galaxy slash Galaxy 2.
Maybe.
Maybe, I don't know. It could
Because
be.
you're because basically what the second person does is just sit there and collect all the little stars as you control Mario.
Yeah. Super Mario 3D World.
Yes.
If your goal is to have
Yes.
fun, if your goal is to have fun and not make any progress, yes.
That's true.
I remember Joe and you and I just all play that, just like have no idea what's
You
going
mean,
on.
wait, Super Mario 3D World? You mean Greg?
Yeah. Greg, yeah, sorry. Yeah, I
Yeah,
remember just
that was really funny.
it. Yeah, it was something. That was it. Was something. Moving forward, we got Broken Age. Broken Age felt more like an animated TV series than a classic adventure game, but it's actually a good thing. Even using a mouse, it was a cinch to play on a big screen and looked lovely in HD. That's that new Tim Schafer adventure game. I've been wanting to play it, but I want to wait until the full thing is out. Not just part one of two parts. So, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, that's that game that got funded with all that Kickstarter money.
Okay.
Everyone keeps telling me it's super awesome, it's super awesome. It looked really cool from what they showed. It's just yeah. The Walking Dead. The first and second season of The Walking Dead were both like tense, well-written TV shows, but with character response when you yell advice to them. Worse if you hand the control back and forth, but also if you quickly confer on the difficult decisions. Yeah, the bad part about that is that game also tells you a lot about your friends, and it also tells like you might not agree on a lot of stuff. Like for instance. Anthony, I'm sure Anthony and I have made plenty of different decisions in those games. Like, I think Anthony, you let Ben die. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Let who die now?
Ben.
Who's Ben?
The kid. Like, the 16-year-old high school kid at the bell tower.
Oh, I saved him.
Okay, I forgot who it was, but I'm
I
done.
for I know there was one really important decision that we kind of argued about.
I know we argued about the food. I took the food, you
Yeah, I
didn't.
did not take the food. And good news, yeah. Creepers.
Yeah.
Wagon.
Yeah, but turns out that like after playing that game and not taking the food, that guy is still an asshole to you no matter what. He's just less of
Yeah.
an asshole. What I will say is going to that car, seeing that the second I saw that car, my first thought was shit. That was my first thought when I saw that card. But that's why that game was fun though. Like you can talk about the different moral decisions and whatnot. I know we had discussions during that second episode. In fact, we might be playing that for 60-Minute Access this week. Or no, this week we're doing Dark Souls 2, but in the future we might be doing that. Sorry everyone, it's just a really packed month. We got Titanfall, we got Final Fantasy, we got Infamous, we got Dark Souls. So just it's hard. Pretty
We
games,
have to
Stefan.
work, okay?
We have day jobs. And Anthony's going to school, and I have day jobs. Okay? I have to promote a commuter company with the local gaming community, and then I have to go answer phones for doctors all day. So, you can imagine how I'm busy. Gears of War 3. I totally get that. Yeah, that one is.
Yeah, I could see that.
That is a great co-op game, especially with four people if you get a LAN going. Oh my god, that game is so much fun with four people. Kenan.
You know what is a great game with people? Halo 1.
Halo Reach.
Halo Reach, but Halo 1 particularly because of LAN parties. to be honest, to actually play a game in the same room.
Oh, when
Mile,
we did that
miles better.
When we did that Halo Reach LAN party, oh my god, that was the best.
Yeah, but Halo Reach LAN party, well, here's the problem. Halo Reach was released in a time when online gaming was so prevalent that the people don't really visit each other's houses, whereas with Halo 1, you actually had to drag your Xbox and TV over to a friend's house to play multiplayer.
Yeah,
and you, like, to put in that kind of effort for, like, the world's most awesome same-room experience ever, yeah.
Yeah, it was legit, I still like that Halo Reach party we had, though.
That was still pretty darn cool. It just doesn't happen as often as, you know, obviously Halo 1.
The Wolf Among Us. Yeah. I'll agree with that. Heavy Rain. Absolutely. Abso-fucking-lutely. Joe and I had a blast playing that game together. You know, and there's multiple reasons why. One, because it was incredibly easy to make fun of. I mean, just so easy.
Or gamey.
Jason! But also because there's actually genuine drama there, and there are so many different paths, that you create this clusterfuck of a path because one of you is making one set of decisions, and when it's like the way Joe and I did it is we switched off each chapter. So when Joe and I did one chapter, it'd be all of Joe's decisions, and another one would be all of mine. And somehow Joe and I got to the good ending doing that.
So you guys are both really different, but at the same time, reach a good moral ending.
Yeah, we managed to keep everyone except the killer alive, and everyone kind of lived happily ever after some fucking way. Which is really funny, because when I talked to Mitch, who was playing the game by himself, the main character hung himself in a jail cell.
Oh my goodness.
So,
wow.
Another ending of that game that I was told about that a friend of mine got was shooting himself over both of his son's graves because he believed he failed as a father.
Okay, that one I can see.
By the way, everyone, I'm sorry I'm spoiling this 4-year-old video game for you. Get over
Look,
it.
Look, it's past 6 months. Like, way, way past 6 months.
Yeah, this
like, you can freaking watch this stuff easily on YouTube.
Yeah. Lego Marvel Super Heroes. Any Lego game is good co-op, really. Like, they're all really fun, really simple, and they're great to play with kids. Like I have little cousins who I've played them with. Like, if you are a parent, those games are a godsend. You know? Let's see. Going forward down the list, Grand Theft Auto 5. I think that's
a hard.
That is hard because part of me is like, yeah, Anthony, I had a ton of fun with that game.
But that's because the only thing we did was driving from convenience store to convenience store, robbing it and yelling into the microphones while everyone in the room can hear us yelling at this poor cashier that's being pointed at with guns. And at the same time, there's only 13 convenience stores we can do it with.
And we were wearing pig masks.
Yeah. Freaking. And I played some Grand Theft Auto Online, and it was a case of, I really don't know. I don't feel like there's that much to actually do. Because it's like, you've got missions, you've got death matches, you've got races, and you've got earning up money to start up your heist, but the thing is that kind of stuff takes time to get there, and from like the 2 or 3 hours I play, it's just kind of a bit hard for me to see how your friends could like enjoy this for 6 hours.
Well, yeah, like it's really hard because the actual game mechanics aren't that good. It's just the fact that you're playing with friends and crazy bullshit happens.
And not only that, but to get good shooting skills, you actually have to farm your shooting skill bar, which takes ages.
Exactly.
So it was just like, and another sign is that, it's Grand Theft Auto Online. Do you think people are talking about Grand Theft Auto Online like it's like the hottest thing right now?
No.
Not really, not since it came out. Now, if you're talking about Grand Theft Auto 5, the game, and not online, even then, I don't know. For one thing, all I did was just sat and watch Bronson try to outrun the cops in a pest control van. So, yeah.
So moving on with this list, Last of Us, absolutely. I have a, not only is The Last of Us multiplayer fantastic, but that game, like, it's great to watch or great to play. I mean, just having people in the same room, oh God, just scary as fuck. It's so tense. I remember Anthony and I, when we did the 6-minute access on this, just both of us are silent, completely silent of the original Last of Us. So
We were?
yeah, we were
Because
pretty
there were
quiet.
clickers nearby?
Yeah, we were dead. We were dead silent.
Yeah, maybe I was so engrossed in the game, I'm just like, oh my goodness, they're gonna do something.
Next up is Outlast. So, for those of you who follow TGA on Twitter and follow our occasional Twitch, where basically what happens is I say I feel like live streaming, and I live stream, and then I tell Nick to tweet it out. So if you've been one of the people that have come to one of those, you saw me. You chances are you saw me play Outlast, and get about an hour into it and say, "Fuck this! This is too scary." Yeah, that game is incredibly frightening. Like, it's fucking horrifying. And it's great to play with friends. It's great to play
Like,
alone.
what did they do exactly to make it terrifying?
They put you in an insane asylum with no weapons.
Oh, so basically what you said, that the only way these days to make a good horror game
Make you a
is to
defenseless
make
little bitch? Yes.
Yeah, because that's how things are scary, is when you have no way of fighting and you could be killed at any second.
Yeah, you have to hide. Like, this one dude's like trying to break in through the door, and like I hid in a locker. And he opened one locker and then figured I wasn't in any of them and left. I was like, oh thank God. And then
Yeah,
when
so
I
it's not like the Resident Evil kind of scary where they just try to throw as many people jumping out of boxes as possible, right?
Yeah, and then like another moment I had that game is you have to turn the generator on by going to all these different rooms. But there are people downstairs with you that can hurt you and shit. So like you hear someone coming, you're like, oh shit, and you have to like hide under the bed and pray they don't see you. It's just, oh God.
Is this like zombies that you're trying to flee from, or is it just normal people?
It's people that have been tested on. So they're not zombies, but they're humans that are just fucked up really bad.
Okay. Wow.
So anyway, moving forward, the last one on the list, I think you'll definitely agree with, because we do it every year, Left 4 Dead 2.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You, Joe, Aaron, and I have so much fun with that it's criminal. It's so good. It's so much fun with you guys when we do that. I don't know why. I really don't. I mean, it's just us goofing around half the time, and
Maybe it's
most
just
of
Valve being very good at it.
yeah, maybe.
Because, what do we really do? It's just us trying to get through a level. Zombies could randomly attack you out of nowhere. And you're calling out for help, like help, 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 and then we get moments like, "Oh crap, the witch, Aaron, look to your right, there's a witch," and you'd be like, "Oh God,"
There's a witch, there's a witch, there's a witch.
and then there'll be times it's like, "Don't startle the witch, don't startle the witch," and then we get moments like, "I startled the witch because I was like the last one to walk by, and just so happens to be me," and then Bronson shuts the door on me.
Look, you need to stop resenting me for this. It's bad for team morale. It's bad for the company.
What's something
Just
that we still resented for?
let it go.
Like, Nick probably still resents the fact that Uncharted 3 didn't win Game of the Year.
Well, that's just
Look, every year we resent each other anyways at the end, okay? Just
I
that this
can't
last one, Nick wasn't there, so, you know.
help it if I was right about Portal 2.
Oh, so that's it now, right? So you were right by default.
It won,
Fact,
didn't it?
Portal 2's
Hey.
better than Uncharted 3, which I agree, but still, I agree that's, in my personal opinion, it's better, but you can't really say I'm right. Just like, what if someone else in their own little world thinks you're wrong?
Well, good for them. They could go start their own website and go get a staff to go argue, and then once they win an argument, they can post it. So,
I'm right because I'm a journalist. Prove me wrong by also being a journalist. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, exactly. Or they can do what we did, where they joined a already successful site and argue their point to get it to be number one.
Wow.
So, yeah, I'm right because I'm a journalist. You can only argue against me if you're a journalist.
Your opinion is more credible because you're a journalist. Doesn't necessarily mean you're right.
No, I'm pretty sure it means I'm right.
Now, there's one thing that, now that we're on this topic, though, I do believe there is one thing that's totally right, though.
What?
Need for Speed isn't very good.
There's a lot of things we say that are very right.
Yes,
Where would you
Need for
like us?
Speed is not good. Okay, I'm sorry. Need for Speed Most Wanted, the Criterion game, is really meh, except for its multiplayer. That
Well,
was it.
that brings me to my next thing
I'm
is because
sorry, if you say that Need for Speed is better than Gran Turismo, you are wrong. Actually, I
I
do
was.
remember the one time when I said, I remember one time when we were up at Lake Tahoe. I was like, yeah, I don't get angry about statements very much. I'm just kind of really meh. And then Alex proceeded to say, okay, Need for Speed is better than Gran Turismo in every way. Yeah, that got me pissed off. As much as I like to say, I'm a person who's, understanding of opinions and don't get angry about something, whenever you bring up Need for Speed, yeah.
The one thing I remember about that drive up to Lake Tahoe is you were going kind of slow, and we were behind Alex, and we were in Bremen's really nice car. And Alex tells me to text you or talk to you and say, "Drive like so and so from Initial D," and you start, and then you start driving, and both of you start driving like badasses. And then we hit traffic and had to stop.
Well, there was a reason why I was driving kind of slow, even though I wasn't like in some tippy SUV or anything. The reason why I drove slow is that honestly, though, I honestly don't know the handling limits of my car. And in addition to that, we were on like mountainous passes where if I go around and turn too fast and hit a guardrail, I don't know if that guardrail is going to stop my car from flinging off the cliff, Because it isn't like some freeway we're on. Freaking the Mount Rose Highway is a little sharp on its turns. And my flying SUV just took out a bicyclist in GTA 5. Poor man. Yeah, I remember that part. Just like driving some dude from Initial D, and I'm just like, I don't know who that guy is, but I know what Initial D is, and not only that, I don't know how you can't drift this thing.
You would probably like that anime. I'm not gonna
I
lie.
probably would, because it's
It's on
about cars.
Netflix, and I know you have access to
Look,
my
when he
Netflix
said
account.
Initial D, I just looked like, it's like, look, I can drive faster, but there's no way I can drift this thing. Okay? My car flat out is not equipped in any way to drift. All it
Hey,
would do is just slide in a guardrail.
I've been in a car with Quinn driving, so I'm officially afraid of no one.
Wow,
That's
really?
Quinn is a terrible driver. Mainly because he has no idea how to navigate, but still, just yeah, I.
Well, everyone gets better eventually, right?
Yeah, well. I don't know. If I had to rank the worst drivers I know, Quinn would be up there. He wouldn't be number one, but he'd be in the top five. Anyway, so Kotaku did an article on the best Xbox One games, and for the most part, I agree with it.
Let's hear it.
Except for the fact that they don't have some games on here. Actually, they don't have two very specific games on here, and I can remove two of these games easily to put those two in. All right, and they also did this for PS4, so I'm gonna do that one next. And it's the 11 best games. Tomb Raider. Okay, absolutely. Tomb Raider was awesome. I gave it an 8.5. If you've never played it, that is the version to play. Well, the next gen ones. Rayman Legends. I'd recommend you play it on the Wii U, but if the only way you can play it is on an Xbox, fuck yes. Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare. I've heard disturbingly good things about that game. Okay.
Disturbingly good.
Yeah, like Plants vs. Zombie Shooter. You would think, oh man, that's gonna suck ass, right? Like, that is the first place you go when you hear that. And would I be correct? You are wrong. It's actually pretty good from what I've heard. Rise, Son of Rome. I've only played a very little of it at my friend Nate's house and my friend Sam's house. And I do not agree with Nick, and I do not agree with this list. I do not think Rise, Son of Rome is that good of a video game, other than the fact that it is really, really, really pretty. I mean, it's a great tech demo. Like, holy shit, if you want to show someone this is why next gen graphics, there you go. Peggle 2. Hell yes.
Peggle.
Need for Speed Rivals.
That's.
I've heard it's pretty good. Like, I've heard it's all right. Like,
Yeah, but Need for Speed these days has just been kind of like a plate of absolute mediocrity. Like, some games aren't bad, but they're not good enough either.
Yeah, Power Star Golf. This is another one where, like, I understand it, but when you see the two games that are missing, you will see why I don't think it should be on there. Strider. Great game, sure. All right. Assassin's Creed 4, Black Flag. Great game. All right, I'm okay with that.
Great if you're not Assassin's Creeding around.
Yes, if you are pirating, it is awesome. If you are Assassin's Creeding, it sucks.
You're pirating, that's funny.
Pirating. I use pirate as a verb. And then Lego Marvel Super Heroes, which it's okay. It's a fun co-op game. And then Dead Rising 3, which is, from what I've heard, pretty good. Where is Forza and Killer Instinct? Why is this Power Star Golf garbage and Rise garbage on here, not those
Look, to be
two?
honest, like, freaking. Look, I'm not really a big fan of Forza anymore, but if Forza 5. Oh, sorry. If Forza 5 is basically Forza 4, but very pretty, I'm totally okay with that.
Anyway,
That's actually still pretty good.
we'll move on to the PS4 because I'm actually equally pissed at that because it's missing one game. Okay, Assassin's
Let me
Creed.
guess, is it Resogun?
No, if it was that, I would have said first off it's Resogun and flip the fuck out. Because Resogun is the best game on that system. Currently.
Okay.
Infamous is not out yet, everyone. Anyway, moving forward. Need for Speed, okay. Strider, all right. Injustice, great game. Doki Doki Universe. I get why, but okay. Lego Marvel Super Heroes, eh. Let's see. Rezogun, fuck yes. Rayman Legends, fuck yes. Don't Starve and Tomb Raider, and Outlast. Okay, I was gonna take out one of those to get back Killzone. Which should be on this list, it would be Doki Doki Universe. Anyway, that's that. I think we're just about out of news, unless you got something. Oh, Windows XP. It's dead, dying.
Yeah, so in small tech news continued, Windows XP is officially going to retire, according to Microsoft at least. For those of you who are not old enough to remember this operating system, when it came out, I should say, Windows XP came out in 2001. Yeah, it's going to be 13 years old, and on April 8th is when they officially are going to pull the plug on supporting it. You could still use it, but Microsoft's not going to give you security updates anymore. And they say that, and you know, when they do something like that, you're pretty much leaving yourself open to any hacks that happen. Now, normally, when they did this with past operating systems like Windows ME, Windows 98, and 95, it wasn't really as big of a deal because everyone moved on from them so quickly that it's like, who cares? But I believe there was a statistic that came out that said like 28 or 30% of computers out there still use Windows XP on
Yeah.
like a regular basis,
Yeah, but these
which in my
people
mind, which in my mind, just it's just mind-boggling.
blows your mind, does it?
It blows my mind because it's like it's 13 years old now. Windows XP, freaking, I remember this stuff when I was like still way back in the early years of grade school, freaking. Windows 98 was okay, but anybody who remembers the operating system probably remembers that blue screen quite frequently. It was okay. Windows ME was absolute garbage because it was one of those things that broke down just sitting on idle. It was also the first time they introduced System Restore, which fixed absolutely nothing. Yeah, so that happened. And Windows 2000 was mainly for business. So you didn't exactly have a good operating system at the time. And then in 2001, Windows XP came out, which everybody likes to, go all nostalgic and say that, oh, it's a good operating system. I think people say it's a good operating system mainly because it was much better than a really bad solution, which was ME. Like, ME didn't last very long. So XP came out, and I remember one of my chief memories of that operating system was playing video games on PC at the time was oh no, our Windows 98 games don't work on XP. What in the world's going on? Because the reason why your Windows 95 game worked in Windows 98 and worked in Windows ME is because they were DOS based. Which I don't want to even explain DOS, because back in those days, installing an operating system meant using DOS, which was freaking. If you try to teach someone today, they'll think, like, how in the world did everyone live with a computer? But Windows XP, they went from DOS to, like, Windows NT or something like that. Quite different, so that's why things didn't work. But, anyways, Windows XP. So, it was good, because it was such a big improvement. I think it was okay. It was okay. It worked well, but man, there were a lot of security issues with that thing. It would catch like stupid, it would catch spyware, malware. Like, I remember one time my computer just kept this stupid thing that kept saying, "Your computer's corrupt, fix it now, fix it now, fix it now." And every time you click X, it keep launching my web browser, and so I had to erase the damn computer every 2 years. And it would just randomly get it for no reason. So yeah, and then today I fixed a couple XP computers, and man, that operating system has not aged well. That or it's so old. Like, Windows Update doesn't even work correctly anymore when you erase the computer, so you have to like apply a hotfix from Microsoft to get the update thing to work. It's kind of sluggish. It's primitive. Just yeah. Yeah, days of XP are kind of over, and seriously, people, it just kind of still boggles me why 30% still use it. It works, but really,
Yeah, people need to let that shit die. All right, well,
yeah,
on
like
to
people just say, "Oh, XP is so awesome." Well, it was awesome at the time, which is a long time ago. It's like 10 years. To be honest, in the late 2000s, it made some sense for you to stick with XP. Actually, to be honest, the late 2000s was just absolutely awful for PC gaming. Not only was the fact that everyone was just moving on to consoles and PCs just got terrible ports, in addition to that, as a PC gamer, as a PC gaming enthusiast, you got a problem. You got Windows XP, which is, what, 7 or 8 years old at the time? Freaking, it's aging. It's aging. It's like DirectX 9.0c. Old. Or you go with Windows Vista, this bloated, fat, sluggish thing that says cancel or allow in your face every time. Things weren't good.
remember Petty
But
Arcade did a comic about that. Cancel the cancel or allow thing. Also,
Mac took advantage of that too. I'm pretty sure everyone remembers. Hi, I'm a Mac, I'm a PC. P Mac sends his salutations, cancel or allow. Allow. Now here's the thing, you can actually shut that thing off. And
so,
then Vista would actually suddenly become okay. You just have to be a bit patient.
breaking news, not related to all the video games or operating systems, but for our fans who watch football, I thought this is probably more interesting.
Yeah.
Eric Decker is now a New York Jet.
He's your
Second number two wide receiver, or was. But fuck that, because the Broncos picked up DeMarcus Ware, TJ Ward, and Aqib Talib. Money,
Everyone's just
money.
going. Everyone's just going to Denver because it's like the ultimate win team now.
We're becoming the New York Yankees of football.
Yeah, which would have been true if that Super Bowl didn't happen.
Yeah, well, hey, you know what? We have improved this off season, so let's hope
It's
we
like
can.
it's just I'm kind of looking I just kind of look at Denver. I'm just like, your goodness, there's a reason why everyone wants to go to Denver. It's like the ultimate win team.
Yeah.
You want to win, come to Denver. It's that simple.
Yeah.
You can't go wrong with Peyton Manning and Wes Welker and Demaryius Thomas and Julius Thomas and yeah. Now you've got DeMarcus Ware.
Dude, DeMarcus Ware and Von Miller. DeMarcus
What was it
Ware.
called? Von Werewolf now?
Yeah, and now it's Von Werewolf.
Dear, wow.
Used to be Von Doom. It used to be Wolf. What was it? Oh God, I forgot what it
Wolf
used to
on
be.
Doom.
Wolf Von Doom or something like that. Now it's Von Werewolf. That's fantastic. I love it. And then we get,
Dear
and then we,
goodness.
now we, and we finally have a strong safety. No more shitty Mike Adams, who's like a billion years old and too slow to cover anyone.
You
Oh
know what
my
I'm also
God.
concerned about?
What?
Julius Peppers.
Oh yeah, there were
He's a
rumors.
maybe, was the last time I saw on your Facebook, right?
Yeah, he.
Because
Oh
he's not
my.
with the Bears anymore, which I kind of looked at him like they terminated his contract, which I'm assuming means they didn't let him finish.
No, so if we sign him, Peppers on one side, Ware on the other, Von Miller on a random side.
That's like
Oh
the
my.
that's like the Dream Blitz team right there.
Oh my God! Like if we get you a 7-point lead. Dear Christ. My God, just
Like
anyway,
I said, it's like the ultimate win team. It's like you want to win, come to Denver.
the Patriots picked up Darrelle Revis. And that's all it for the big ones here, it looks like.
Yeah,
Let's
meanwhile
see.
at the Bears, I haven't been paying much attention to them because it's kind of a little hard for me to care these days.
Yeah,
Their philosophy just kind of doesn't click with me anymore because it changed that much. Basically, from what I can tell, they signed a lot of people to 1-year contracts.
that sounds about right. Oh, Jarius Bird, the top safety in free agency, went to the Saints.
Okay.
So, moving forward, we got questions.
Josh McCown is no longer at Chicago.
He is a Buccaneer.
And which is kind of funny, because at Tampa Bay they did hire Lovie Smith. And
Yeah,
Josh McCown
it.
did come in kind of as an emergency back in 2011 when Lovie Smith was still the coach of the Chicago Bears.
They are picking up a lot of Chicago Bears. I'm not even gonna.
Well, yeah, who do you think? Well, yeah, what do you think their head coach was?
Well, yeah, I realize that, but still, like that's still a surprise to me.
I don't know, Tampa Bay is really excited to have Lovie Smith, so, you know, history and everything. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, so now it's like, okay, when Jay Cutler gets hurt, let's see how well our backup does.
I wonder who you guys are gonna
Oh.
sign.
Well, I know we have Jordan Palmer, who is the brother of Carson Palmer.
Oh, that's gonna turn out
And one other person
so
I've never heard of.
well. Let me see if you. Hold on, I
Oh yeah,
actually haven't.
so Devin Hester was quietly let go.
Yeah, I
To
saw about
freaking
that.
no like no mention of it on the Chicago website whatsoever. Like it wasn't a headline at all.
Let's see. I'm gonna see. I know I have a site that grades the free agent signings, so let me see what they gave. Let's see if you've signed. No, you guys haven't really signed anyone.
Not yet, yeah.
I know that they gave DeMarcus Ware an A
Which
plus.
is kind of, I think it's like we signed like a bunch of decent people. Kind of as an emergency, like a
Yeah.
backup plan in case the draft completely falls apart somehow. It's like we got a safety from I think Green Bay and maybe another one from New York, the New York Giants. It's like I said, I don't keep up these days because it's just kind of like I kind of don't care anymore.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm excited for this upcoming season. I'm hoping that third time's the charm. We got bit in the divisional, we got bit in the Super Bowl. But this is the year we come back with a vengeance.
Well, you're certainly setting up your defense a lot better for it.
Well, our defense would be a lot better, would have been a lot better last year if half of it wasn't hurt. So, healthy along with improved players always helps.
Champ Bailey's not there anymore.
Yeah, Champ Bailey played in two regular season games last year. So, I'm sorry, but Champ Bailey at this point in his career was a solid corner, a number two, you know, the guy you would put next to what old Champ Bailey was. But he was injury prone and we were paying him $10 million. Which I'm sorry, but $10 million a season is reserved for shutdown corners. You know, no offense to the man. Champ Bailey was fantastic for this team. This team owes him a lot for sticking with us, and I wish we could have got him a ring. You know, personally, I'm hoping he realizes that he is no longer worth $10 million a season, when no one in the free market should give it to him. Christ hopes they don't. Or Christ, I hope they don't. And then he re-signs with us for cheap. But that's, yeah. Yeah. Anyway, moving forward, we need to talk about those questions and comments. First question or comments from outside of the box. I'm 100% certain that the Xbox One 360 sales will be higher than the PC. The question comes down to whether the 360 version will be higher than the Xbox One or not. I believe pre-orders are higher on Xbox One. The 360 does have a bigger install base. It would have been nice to see how many people would have been in the beta if 360 had one. It's a toss-up, but I'll give it to Xbox One due to pre-orders and Microsoft advertising.
Well, I don't know if I want to say that Xbox 360 sales will be higher than the PC. Because, to be honest, a lot of people on the PC buy their games digitally, and those things aren't exactly tracked.
Yeah.
In addition, there is a group of people who are most adamant that the only way you can ever play a shooter is via PC, because you can aim a lot better. So, and PC gaming is a lot bigger than it used to be. So Xbox One sales, yes, I think that it will do better than PC just because of sheer hype and the Titanfall bundle, and you know it can be easily be advertised as the Xbox One game of the month. But 360, I don't know.
I don't think the 360 version is going to do well at all.
I mean, like I said it last week, like Legend of Zelda: Twilight Princess.
Yeah.
Yeah, you had 20 million GameCubes versus like maybe only 2 million Wiis, but guess what? The Wii version is what people remember. It's the version that people bought, and the GameCube version just doesn't come up to people's minds. Of course, it didn't have like the big selling point of, oh, it has, you know, the Wii version had motion controls, which helped it get more publicity. But in this case, we're talking about this is the Xbox One, the next generation. How about you bring in a new, fresh shooter with your Xbox One. Not to mention, we know nothing about the 360 version other than it got delayed.
Yeah, so that's pretty much. Yeah, I pretty much agree with that. That seems about right. Moving forward, we got from Groover. This is the only picture I've seen with Amy Hennig's face so close to Batman's crotch. Glad we can provide you with entertainment, good sir. Continuing to move forward. Mochaccino says, I think it's pathetic they haven't shown anything on 360. Talk about suppressing information. It's called marketing, bro. Sorry to say,
when you want to sell your new system, let's market it from the new system. make people buy the new system, make people think the only place they could buy it is the new system. Actually, make it seem like the best place you can buy it. I mean, they kind of do this with multiplats too. Like, for example, the Mass Effect 3 in the commercials, they said better connect with Xbox 360, and I do emphasize the box because they pronounce it like BAWX instead of BOX. Yeah, Xbox 360.
Yeah.
Anyways. Yeah, all like right. in that case, you kind of think, ooh, so it's a 360 optimized game. Now, we actually did say last week that I think some people did say that it was originally a 360 game that got ported up to Xbox One, but even then, if with enough marketing, people will think it's better on Xbox One.
So, moving forward, we have Solid Kratos. Oh boy, Solid Kratos, as always, a novel. But luckily, we kind of need a novel this week because Nick isn't here, Barry isn't here, Bremen isn't here. We couldn't get any guests. So, you know. Kind of good. Kind of a good thing. Anyway, he says, here we go. With Microsoft coming out with DirectX 12, what's your opinion on how it will improve PC gaming? Where your remote is on GDC, Microsoft hints that the Xbox will somehow use it. So the rumors for DirectX 12 is that it'll make it so cards that support it will be able, like, it'll make it so that machines will optimize games better, which means lower-end machines will be able to use, that have DirectX 12 will be able to run, you know, higher-end stuff, which is good, because that means graphics cards will stay around longer, which means you won't have to spend as much money to be a PC gamer. Well, that's always nice. And as far as it being on the Xbox One, that'll be good because, well, better optimization means games look better and the Expo might be able to finally show stuff at 1080p, similar to how the Wii U rolls. Yes, I said that on purpose.
I don't know much about DirectX 12. So, actually, so to kind of sum it up as best as I could. So, AMD had released this new graphics API to compete against OpenGL and DirectXX. They call it Mantle. And the goal of Mantle, in order to achieve big performance games, is to, instead of a high level, because when you code for graphics, DirectX 11, I would say, and OpenGL, they're what we call high level. Basically, it's like it's dumbed down and translated to a point where it's easier to make things happen. It's much like it's like having a translator, a very good translator, where you say, I want this to happen, and you can turn that one sentence into like 500 different steps and just make things easier. However, the problem with high level is that it can make things slow. As you can imagine, if you say one thing and it translates into 500 lines, well, what happens if those 500 lines, you just want to change this one little thing? Well, it can be complicated. It could bloat things very easily. So AMD came up with this thing called Mantle, which it can make things much lower level. You have much more direct control of exactly what you want to happen. Now, the idea is that you reduce the CPU load, in addition to making the GPU work more efficiently because you have more control over what it does. And this in turn actually gave pretty good frame rates. Unfortunately, Mantle didn't exactly get a very good footing because the flagship game that's supposed to show off Mantle is Battlefield 4. And Battlefield 4 didn't exactly get off to a good start at all. In addition to that, Mantle wasn't officially, the driver for it wasn't officially released until like months after Battlefield 4. And even then, that driver is like still in beta or something. So Mantle's not off a good start. So I imagine I think DirectX 12 is a response to Mantle, where it's like, okay, we're gonna take out some of this bloated high-level translation stuff and make it closer to the hardware so you have more control so things run more efficiently. Now, it probably makes it a little bit more difficult for the programmers because they actually have to learn the hardware a bit more now or something like that. And new commands and whatever to make it work. But the goal is that by reducing some of the bloat, you get a more efficient, you get more efficient processing and therefore better frame rates.
All right. Moving
as
forward.
For having DirectX 12 on the Xbox One, I think that might be a good thing because, you know, in the case of the Xbox One, you need whatever little advantage you can have to compete against the PS4. And the PS4, you don't. And with the PS4, you obviously can't use DirectX because obviously they don't have like a Microsoft operating system. Whereas the Xbox One operating system might be just be a Windows operating system. It just happens to look different. And I believe the PS4 probably uses OpenGL or something like that. And OpenGL hasn't exactly came up with a bloat reducing method implementation version 5, whatever, yet. So you never know. DirectX 12 and Xbox One might be the gap closer in performance. Which would be quite shocking if that's actually true.
All right, so moving forward, we have a question. We have the next question. So Titanfall came out instead of Dark Souls 2. I was wondering which do you prefer, and if you have Dark Souls 2, will you do Six Masters? Because I would love to see you guys rage on that game.
Oh, I won't be the one raging.
Yeah, because I'm the one playing it. We played the Titanfall beta, but we haven't bought the full game yet, because I was going to buy it on PC, but I'm going to buy an Xbox One when I get my tax return, which should be in my account within the next 2 weeks. So I'm waiting. As for Dark Souls, we got it through Gamefly. We're gonna do 6-minute access of it. So yes, your wishes will be granted. As for which I prefer, well, from what I played of Dark Souls 1 and from what I played of the Titanfall beta, it's hard to compare them because they're two totally different game styles. It's kind of asinine to try and compare them. But if I had to, I guess I'd probably prefer Titanfall. But that's just kind of how I roll. That's about it for me. What about you?
When it comes to Dark Souls, the only experience I have is Demon Souls, which is a long time ago. That's like nearly 5 years. That's like 4.5 years now. So, I guess the question is between Titanfall and Demon's Souls from my personal experience. I think I would rather play Titanfall because Demon's Souls, I highly respect Demon's Souls and I actually like it. It's just that I could only beat the first boss, and that was the first real boss, and that was only barely. Barely. And oh dear, did I feel like that this game is really good for me to rent, just not buy. So, whereas with Titanfall, it just kind of gives me this wow factor with the first impression. So I lean more towards Titanfall.
All right then. So going forward, what is your opinion on Microsoft? Uncertain of Microsoft's investors wanting to get rid of the Xbox brand altogether, and the CEO of Microsoft considering it, though it's not likely going to happen anytime soon. And if it were happening, do you think this would mean the future of Microsoft with its power of the cloud and the Xbox brand? I think that people say crazy shit all the time and it never happens.
Here's the thing, though. Investors say crazy things all the time because they don't know much.
Yeah.
Because it's like, on one hand, I kind of agree that they should retire the Xbox brand. Because at this point, because back in 2001, it kind of made sense to call your system the Xbox. For one thing, it sounds aggressive, like compared to the PlayStation and the Nintendo GameCube. Xbox. Kind of has that sharp, aggressive edge to it.
You know why it's called the Xbox, don't you?
They originally called it Direct Xbox, which was kind of stupid, so Xbox.
They wanted to make a gaming system based around DirectX, so its code name was the Direct Xbox, and they were focus testing it to people, and people liked the name Xbox.
Yeah, but anyways, like regardless of the origin of the name, Xbox, that just sounds aggressive and, to be honest, kind of bro-ish.
Well, I mean, it is the system for bros, because I mean,
I know, but the name itself just happens to coincide with that quite nicely, if I'm honest.
Yeah.
It's the alpha male game system, or at least the closest to one. that isn't that that's actually successful in some way. But yeah, the Xbox just kind of has this sharp edge, and you think it's like it's aggressive, or it's more aggressive, I should say. It's more aggressive. It has this sharp tone. It's kind of has like this sharp tone. However, the problem is that that's a pretty cool name for a game system, even though it may sound like the kind of game system for dudes who like to drive jacked up pickup trucks. The thing is that while that may be a good name for a game system, over time, though, it increasingly became a media system, almost to the point where, with the Xbox One, when they first announced it, it became a media system that plays game that can play games instead of a gaming system that does media features. It kind of seems like a priority change. So I just kind of thought that they should have just stopped calling it the Xbox and just given it a different name because the focus had changed so much. At the same time, the Xbox has name recognition. Because if you dropped that and called it something else, now with Nintendo, you could do this just fine. Because to be honest, Nintendo's a game company, so you know for sure that whatever they call their next hardware, you know it's about playing video games. With Microsoft, if they drop the Xbox name and stick it with something else, people are gonna like, wait, is this a game system or is it a smart TV or is it some extension of Windows? Is it a peripheral for Windows? You don't really know. That's my concern with them dropping the Xbox name.
All right, well, we're gonna move on. So Verizon wanting to charge more for gamers, AT&T's new patent possibly charge gamers more for downloading games, even streaming. How do you think it'll affect consumers overall? I think this kind of crap is bullshit. But first off, AT&T, but like, oh God, just first off, no, just no. I'm sorry, but look, there's a way the internet works now. And the way it works is I pay a monthly fee and I get as much internet as I like. You know, I'm sorry, but you can say all this other shit you want, but there's no way you can rig this that people are going to be okay with it and not give you double middle fingers and go to another provider. I'm sorry. It's just not going to work. Unless you live in an area like Bridget in the middle of bumfuck Egypt where you have no choice. But here we have fucking options. Like here you can go to AT&T or Charter or Verizon or and I think even Comcast is in our area. So, that's that.
The problem, oh man. I said this last week. In hindsight, it makes sense. It's like pay as you go if you don't use your internet very much, like a lot of older people do. No biggie. You save money on your internet actually by doing that. But the problem is that the internet isn't exactly like gasoline, where it is something that disappears as you use. With gasoline, I can burn it up, and then I have to drive to the gas station and fill up the gas tank again, and I have to pay for that. Whereas with the internet, I don't think you're burning up anything other than making a router work slightly harder. And so if you, and I don't know. Are they losing money? Like, the thing I would ask them is that from a financial standpoint, okay? It's just like, okay, I understand that from hindsight, from how you're describing, oh, gamers use so much more bandwidth that it just plugs up our routers and makes things slow for everyone else. Okay, so tell me, are you losing money with your current arrangement? Like, are you losing money out of your current?
They aren't. Look, AT&T
It's just
phone.
like, is it like, is the game, is like the people who stream YouTube videos constantly, constantly downloading programs, constantly downloading games, like, are they causing you financial strain of having to pull in even more routers and servers to make the internet keep functioning? Or are you like, is it like causing a di is it causing an inconvenience for everyone else? Now, from my experience and Bronson's experience, actually, no. We play games and our internet doesn't slow down just because Halo 3 came out. Sorry, not Halo 3 came out, but Titanfall comes out, and the internet area didn't slow down one bit. Actually, to be honest, it runs exactly the same.
Pretty much.
And I don't know what it's like in big cities. So, if gamers are, like, causing you to lose money and are plugging up your router really hard, then maybe... Maybe, but the problem is you have to convince people of this because everyone's just going to revolt. And in the case of our area, like Bronson pointed out, we're just going to switch to someone else.
Yeah,
and we live in an area with competition. So if you're going to make it annoying for us, we're just going to go to someone else who isn't making it annoying for us. And I'm pretty sure they want our business.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's not true everywhere. Like I said, the Midwest is, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
But, man, I really don't know.
Okay, so moving forward, let's see. Also, there's a letter with a petition to sell by gamers for Verizon not to do this shit, which, good. That's, look, the thing is, a letter isn't going to stop them. It's you as a consumer giving them the middle finger and saying no.
The problem is that petitions don't exactly work very well. Because, let's be honest here, they have a customer base of, what, let's assume 30 million, and a petition gets, like, 30,000 signatures. Do they think that that 30,000 signatures represents 30 million people?
So first off, let me get this here for you, everyone. Cash is your megaphone. That's how you get people to give a shit. And that, you know, so that means if you don't want Verizon to do this, you know, the second that they try it or try anything like it, switch providers or switch to, or fucking, do the alternative, whatever it is. If that means like using satellite internet, like, well, hey, at least satellite internet, you don't have a data cap, right? Even if it is like only 1 megabyte download speeds.
Oh, wow.
That would be my opinion on that. And and as someone who works for one of these giant cell phone companies, they honestly do not give a fuck about you. The average client, they give a shit about losing a lot of average clients. So like if
like I said, it's like I said, this happens in a lot of places, but like I said, it's like the petition is probably 30,000 signatures out of their entire 30 million customer consumer base.
Well, I mean, so here's the thing. AT&T has all kinds of, or I'm going to use AT&T as an example because that's who I'm with and that's who I worked for. AT&T, your 120, even if you have a fucking astounding account that's like 10 years with AT&T and you pay $300 a month, they really still don't give a fuck about you, because I did an account for Boeing once, which monthly they were paying roughly $700,000. So your fucking $300 is just dropping the bucket. Now, if the entire city of, say, Reno held up double middle fingers to AT&T because of this and went over to Charter or vice versa, yeah, then AT&T would lose their shit. Cash is your megaphone, and cash, all those people signing that petition, instead of signing a petition to send to Verizon, they should sign that petition and then tell Verizon, hey, you do this, I'm canceling my service. And then if they actually, if Verizon continues to do it, they should cancel it. Money talks. You know how everyone bitched about the Xbox One? It's not the bitching that changed it. It's the 4-to-1 pre-orders on PS4 that changed it.
To be honest, though, when you're talking about a significant amount of outrage, I think that also contributed.
Oh, yeah.
Because you think about it, nearly everybody hated the Xbox One. Nearly everybody. Almost everything that you read about the Xbox One from the average person said they don't like it. They don't want it. Okay? In addition to you being outsold, you also have this negative press going around. Like, not negative press, but negative opinion, just overwhelmingly bad. So, yeah.
Yeah, but
now,
like...
Now, my concern is that... The big concern is that AT&T and Verizon, if they go ahead with this, gamers probably make paying gamers, I should say. Like, if your parents are paying for the internet, you probably can't really do much, unfortunately, because unless your parents also rebel against this idea as well. But the percentage of their customer base that are gamer and pay for the service probably isn't that much. Maybe it is. Maybe it isn't. But somehow I have this bad feeling that it isn't enough for them to turn away from this. Chances are you have no other place to go and you will be forced to pay for it.
I am saying that yeah, there are going to be cases like that, but in a lot of cases, there are people like you and I, and I know there are people in big cities and several other several places who, if data caps happen, if charging more for bandwidth happens, they can just say fuck you and move. You know, and that's honestly what I would do. That's how you should react. Money fucking talks. That's what talks. Money fucking talks. Money talks. Money talks, money talks, money talks. Money talks. And that's, in this case, that's what you have to do. You have to, for instance, right now, AT&T is my cell phone provider. I'm happy with them. I'm in contract with them. And when my contract runs out, I'll probably renew. That's not, but let's say AT&T says, we decided to say we're going to do something asinine, like get rid of our unlimited texting plan and not grandfather it. So you have to start paying more for texting. I would hold up double middle fingers and proceed to go over to Verizon.
Not to mention, that kind of idea would get a significant amount of people angry.
Yeah.
Specifically our generation.
Yeah, well,
because if our generation found out about that, you bet they just lost a huge amount of customers. They would be getting a bad reputation, and they wouldn't get new customers because of this bad stuff going around.
The thing is, everyone texts now too. Like, my mom texts.
I know, but our generation probably texts more than anyone else.
Oh, for sure. Well, actually,
So you can bet that if they made a decision like that, you bet would be, like, I think that's probably why the Xbox One was just so unpopular, because it's a large number of people who buy Xbox 360s are still gaming enthusiasts. It wasn't just the average mom and dad buying just Call of Duty for a night or two. But it was still your core base is it's they're leaving you. And the numbers show they're leaving you. They're telling everybody about it. And you've got a disaster on your hands. So better fix things up.
So moving forward.
Something to really game movie, they have to really disturb a fundamental thing.
Yeah.
People to get really angry, which for internet, charging more for gamers, I think there aren't enough of us to change that, and the average consumer is not going to care. Because they're not downloading 20 gigabyte games every week.
No, but you say that, but Netflix eats a fucking huge amount of bandwidth. And how many people with Netflix are going to be like, fuck you, and
totally... That's a good point. That is a good point, video
streaming. And people on YouTube, people on Netflix are just going to be like...
Yeah, but is that 20 gigabytes a week, though?
Dude, that's...
20 gigabytes a week.
Well,
unless you're watching Netflix every single minute you're home... I mean, I don't even know how much Netflix uses. It's not 20 gigabytes a week, because games are 5 to 15 gigabytes per game or something like that.
Anthony, you would be surprised. Let me put this in perspective for you. My mom watches a lot of Netflix, and I watch a lot of Netflix. When we didn't have internet for a week, we used my phone. We used my phone to do stuff and watch. I watched movies on my phone during that period. I burned up through 2 gigs in 4 days. So, and that was on a phone where the quality isn't as good. So that takes less bandwidth. And it wasn't every minute of every day. It wasn't nearly as much as the average person watches television. And then you're like my mom, where you're like homebound or more of a homebody. But yeah, no, you will burn through like 15 gigs a week-ish, I would say. And yeah, no, just absolutely. Yeah, this is. For sure. You will. That uses a ton of data. There's no way you can do this without pissing somebody off immensely. There's
I
no
wouldn't say
fuck.
somebody, pissing a lot of people off, more
Yeah,
like.
like you. There's no way you can do this without just pissing a ton of people off. It's. There's just no way. The only way this could get passed is if your speeds are unbelievably fast. And I mean, like,
If I can download
unbelievable.
a game in 2 minutes, you are good.
Yeah. If you can
Fiber
down,
optic, go.
yeah. If you have like
Like, there needs to be a
fiber,
trade-off, right?
yeah. There needs to be a
Actually, that kind of
trade-off.
reminds me. Let me tell you, a lot there are a lot of people out there that are our parents' age, that get very sensitive to the slightest sign of a price increase. For example, in our area, Charter has recently required that anybody that has cable has to have digital cable boxes now. Now, mind you, this adds, I believe, $7 or $10 per unit to your monthly bill. Yeah, you can bet a lot of people complained about that because there are a lot of people, like my parents and Bronson's mom, who will notice that kind of bill and will complain, even though it's only $20 or $30 a month.
Shit, dude. Dude,
Yeah.
when I worked for AT&T, I had people come in and complain about like an extra $2. So
Yeah,
trust me.
there are a lot of people like that. Because let's be honest, when you're an adult and you want to save money for your th for other things like, rainy day funds and everything like that, a $2 increase on your phone bill somehow becomes a lot more irritating when you're 40 than when you're 25.
Yeah.
So, yep.
So,
Okay.
moving on. So, Sony is saying they'll unveil their secret weapon at GDC, which will be their VR headset. I was wondering, in your opinion, these VR headsets that Sony will produce in the Oculus Rift, do you think it'll be a game changer, bring something new to the table that'll change the ways people game, or to game? I think that they're a neat idea, and I think they'll be cool in certain situations. But at the end of the day, people don't want to stick shit on their head. People only want to do motion controls in social gatherings and rare occasions. This is kind of be in that field of this is going to be cool for some very select games, and then otherwise you're going to want to be at your computer monitor or at your TV, comfortable and playing in the traditional way. I'm sorry, it's just until you can zap someone into a computer, Matrix style, we're not going to have virtual reality or anything like it.
I've seen some people got excited about, the Oculus
Oh no,
Rift.
I'm writing an article about the Oculus Rift. I think it's a cool idea. It's just that I just don't see it taking off.
Yeah, like I've seen some people get a little excited about the Oculus Rift. My concern is that it's not going to work very well practically, and this is why. So these virtual reality headsets, they basically enclose your entire field of vision. Now, the reason why you can play video games without getting a headache is because that when you look at your TV, you still kind of have a frame of reference, so you don't become disorientated. You still know that you are sitting still and you're not going to get dizzy or anything. With the Oculus Rift, your entire vision is taken up by this headset thing. And what I think might happen is you are going to see that you are moving, but your body doesn't detect that it's moving, and it's going to create this really confusing experience. Because it's like, but it's clear that I am moving. It's like this one time when I was sitting in this car wash, and I didn't see the ground, nor did I look what's in front of me. I just looked to the side and watched as this machine moved this bar that was spraying water on the car, and I was so focused on this thing that I thought the car was moving forward because that's what I'm used to, and I was so confused. And all of a sudden, I realized, oh my goodness, we're not moving! And oh wow, it was disorientating. So, I think that's going to create a sense of confusion, and I think it might cause dizziness also. Because to play a first-person shooter with your entire field of vision being taken up by that thing probably might not be good for some people's health. So that's my concern with the Oculus Swift. It's really cool if you're using it to sit down and watch like a tour guide, but if you want to play a shooter or Mass Effect or sci-fi or Star Wars TIE Fighter with that thing, you're probably gonna feel you might feel ill afterwards. That's just my personal thought of it. Not to mention, though, cost. Yes, this isn't Virtual Boy expensive, but it probably won't be Virtual Boy expensive, but still, it's like,
To finish it off, so if you haven't talked about it yet, can you talk about the whole Dread Fox voice of Parappa the Rappa? Well, a bunch of fans wanted to make a fan video and ask Dread to voice a few lines. Dread asked for $6 and they decided to pay, but then Dread said he, quote, talked with his agent, needs $100 because some bullshit reason. Group paid $100 for some lines, but Dread did not do what he was paid for. And after 6 months, the group called Dread, called him out on his bullshit, and Dread pushed off like nothing. At that point, he said he is legendary, the group is full of shit, and the whole fan war started between the group and Dread and his fans. Well, that makes Dread kind of an asshole, but then again,
To pay the guy $100 just to say a few lines, really?
yeah, like that's a waste of $100 to
And
me.
then to just and then only to find out that he didn't do what he was paid for and then just brush it off and then decides to call your group shit?
That
This is
sucks.
something I can't really comment on, but
It sucks that
from a
that.
financial perspective, I don't think it's a good idea to pay a person $60 just to say a few lines. And then all of a sudden he starts to contact his agent just to say a few lines. For all I know, I could have just sat down with this microphone that I'm using, say a few lines, and send it off to somebody. And they wouldn't even have to pay me because it only takes me back probably 2 minutes to read it all.
Yeah,
But
so.
$60, and then he contacts his agent, like, I probably would have sounded the warning flag if the $60 mark was reached. That's just, or his agent. I'm just like, really? You need to talk to your agent just to say a few lines?
Yeah, I'm. Oh, man. Yeah, this sucks for them. This guy is kind of a prick, but then again, this kind of bit them because why would you. Really? Like, $100? Even $60, like honestly, like, man, okay. Anyway,
I mean, if I could. Like, well, you kind of think about it. They are big fans. I try to understand the reasoning. Like, they're big fans of Parappa the Rapper.
Yep.
And, you know, they think, oh man, this guy did something great. He probably loves it too. Maybe we can get his help. Yeah, sure, we'll help. Yeah, sure, we'll all pitch in financially to, you know, get his help. But I guess they never really saw that just because a person did something cool doesn't necessarily mean they're also cool in real life.
Yeah.
Like, for example, I would freaking think it's amazing if I could get Brandon Keener to voice a few things for whatever project I work in the future. And Brandon Keener is the voice actor of Garrus Vakarian in Mass Effect, which would be freaking awesome. At the same time, I don't have any idea what he's like in real life. I just know him as an actor, not what he really is. Which is a sign, which, you know, something to be careful about.
Yep. Anyway. That'll be that. That's the last question and/or comment. Sorry, short episode this week, folks, but you
It's not
know.
short. We're at 2 hours, 15 minutes.
Holy shit, really?
Yes, really.
Okay, well, anyway, we're on iTunes. Go there, review us, get your friends to review us, as many reviews as possible, because we have, obviously, we have high star ratings, because you guys all love us. So that means we'll be in the top podcast once we have enough reviews. So reviews, 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 reviews. You're on YouTube. Go there, watch them, spread us around, subscribe, etc., etc. That's about it. Upcoming video, 6 minutes of Dark Souls, 60 minutes of. This is just for the general upcoming month, everyone, so not like the next week. But 6 minutes of Dark Souls, 6 minutes of Final Fantasy, 60 minutes of Titanfall, possibly 60 minutes of Infamous. and 60 minutes of Metal Gear. So you are going to keep us busy. Also, we are going to finish Okami before we die. We swear.
Yeah.
I don't know. I actually think this would be a really good week to do some Okami since all that we have is Dark Souls.
Yeah.
But anyway, have a good week. We love you. We love all our fans. Comment. Give more comments and questions. Feel free to add us on PSN or Xbox Live or whatever gaming network of choice. Just ask in the comments and we'll tell where we are. You have anything, Anthony?
Oh, that's all, really.
All right. Well, this has been Unscripted Access, everybody, and we will talk with you next week. Next
Okay.
week. Next week. Bring it back now.